is our next speaker here? Yes, good, excellent. So, our next speaker is Michael Dinkun from Erie, and we did hear a couple of times from Sierra.
Changed.
Oh, it's changed. Okay. What I was just about to say is relevant anyway. We did hear a couple of mentions earlier on in talks about rice phenotyping and actually being a fairly rapid linkage between genotype and phenotype, Sigrid Hoyer's work, for example, being a case in point. So I think we're very interested to hear from Michael, and the title of his talk is Phenotyping and GWAS for Rice Improvement, a Strategy and Partial Results Towards Multi-Trait Idiotype Construction by Genome Editing. There's a lot in there. Let me just get rid of this.
Okay, and then make it big. Doesn't respond.
Doesn't move it really well, so hang on a bit. Hang on a bit and fold it right. There we go. What?
Okay, what? So, good morning. I will talk to you less about how we do phenotyping, but what we want to do with it, what is the purpose and the strategy. This is the roadmap of my presentation. We want to end up with a shortcut strategy to idiotype implementation is real plants. So phenotyping for a specific purpose. We set ourselves one goal among several, actually, to develop storm-proofed, lodging-resistant, high-yielding plant types. And this is in the context, so far, of the GRISP Global Rice Phenotyping Network that has been running since 5 years now and will now migrate into the Global Rice Array, which is a larger international collaboration on rice phenotyping and rice breeding. The GRISP network had three major projects that you see at the bottom. One of them, the third one, a collaboration with the private sector, Syngenta. So phenotyping for us is only one component of an integrated research agenda. So you can see at the top, we have of course, the genomic side, sequence information, we have the phenomics, and that feeds into GWAS or other ways of analyzing this, and leads then into a very tedious, very important process of filtering of the results, prioritization of the associations that we find, haplotype analysis, the validation of function of genes and polymorphisms that we find, effect validation for those, and background interaction, which then leads us to a library of functional validated SNPs of polymorphisms. That is actually the main result that enables doing something with it. And the way from GWAS to having that library is very, very far. Okay, this is assisted by TPE characterization, so you know for what environments you have to do what, and idiotype prediction. Now regarding the idiotypes, I don't go into detail at all there. We did an idiotype optimization study for yield potential for irrigated rice, doing some sort of virtual breeding with the Samara crop model. I can't really say much about this now because of time. you create virtual recombinants for key traits. You select from those virtually in under different cultural practices, seasons, sites, in this case India and Philippines, and climate change scenarios as well. And you analyze the best performing trait profiles. On the left hand side here you see some traits that came out of that. The last one I find particularly important, reserve storage in stems that can be recycled into a grain filling. And now we are combining this with another major objective, lodging resistance. We developed for that, see a photo here, what we call a blaster, a turbine that we take into the field with artificial rain, makes a wind channel that you see on the right side in the field, very narrow, 1 meter wide only, and that gives us an objective measure of the lodging resistance. And then we of course look into the component traits. And those component traits that contribute to the lodging resistance are listed on the right, and there's quite a number of interesting stuff. I mean, with rice, other than wheat, for example, the sheath that envelops the stem, or the culm, is the main organ that provides stability. And its senescence, for example, leaf senescence, therefore, plays a role in lodging resistance. No more detail on this, but you can ask me later on. Our high-throughput phenotyping is not particularly exciting. We can't do it everywhere. We have not much money. We are doing it, but much of the stuff we are doing is still manual. And actually, if anybody can give us an idea how we can do yield components, high-throughput, or even remote sensing, that would be really of great interest to us. But I don't think anybody comes up with that. Soon enough. So we have data sets, quite comprehensive, but based on relatively small diversity panels, 200 to 300 accessions, depending on the case, subspecies panels, and we have three different domains of phenomics resources, yield potential component traits, thermal adaptation traits, including the phenology, and stem lodging resistance traits. So these together give us the ammunition to develop a plant type and also to prioritize traits for breeding. We have quite good genomics sequence resources for all those. That's at the left, the bottom. Okay, so for the following traits, we have very promising GWAS associations, and we are advancing on having operational polymorphisms that are effective. So the three domains, yield potential, phenology, and lodging resistance, and you can see that these are fairly detailed traits in terms of morphology, chemistry at the bottom also, and the C4 rice project helps us a lot to provide for photosynthesis related traits. So that is basically the resource that we have for our panels, and the challenge is then to extract from that truly causative polymorphisms. We are successful in some cases already, but this is a lot of work. Everybody has seen Manhattan plots like this, and we are taking out the major associations and finding out what is behind those. Now, piecing this together and how to get towards the implementation of a plant type. On the left-hand side, you see, so dry here. You see what I described earlier, so the phenomics and sequence information that through jivas then feeds into a into either a more conventional marker-assisted selection scheme with back crosses and all that, which is very time-consuming, or alternatively, you can identify the causative SNPs and do targeted genome edits. We are starting to be able to do that. It requires some more methodological research to be really efficient. And that would be a shortcut in the breeding pipelines. You get into the tail end, and you don't have to do so many crosses. Ideally, none at all. Genomic selection, of course, is being pursued in parallel, and those markers can be put into mixed models. Modeling is involved in several steps. These are the yellow stars. So, for this shortcut strategy using genome editing, where are we today? We have a couple of labs, collaborators, we're working together. The premise, we think that causative high effect SNPs will be the future currency, that they will have enormous value, especially if you have large libraries and if these are very well validated resources. The CRISPR-Cas9 system permits precise deletions or insertions. Problem is, as of now, that knock-ins, so precise substitutions, don't work efficiently yet. And more work is needed to be done there in order to have a very clean and targeted substitution of single bases or small groups of bases. So that is the holy grail in a way, but I think in a few years we will be there. For us, it works pretty well, especially if you use protoplast systems and you regenerate the plant. Of course, germline edits and editing into the germline are still tedious because you have to be homozygous and you have to be in the germline itself. Multi-edits are possible, and that's a great chance. Many traits or many polymorphisms you can theoretically edit in one go. So soon we may do a la carte edits in into elite materials, and ideally with no process involved. This is of course not entirely possible because there may be some collateral damage in the editing process in the genome, and you have to clean it up and so forth. But enormous time savings and great opportunities to make new things in a short time. So there are partner laboratories involved in this, or in we are only starting the genome editing side of it. CIRAD, IRI, CIRAD, Rothamsted International. Some talks with Wageningen have been going on. The consortium is still open. The funding is even much more open. as a backdrop to this project, this will be part of the work in the Global Rice Array, which starts now in January. We will have a kickoff meeting in March. There will be a large international network of sites, and that will combine at the hubs, a dozen or one half dozen hubs, where we will combine antenna trials, Jiva EBM for subpopulations that feeds into the modeling across so many environments, and we have the high throughput phenotyping at those sites too, and these sites are ideally located close to breeding programs. So that is the backdrop to this, but the money has to come mainly from elsewhere. So we have here a potential breakthrough project in search of a donor in order to perform direct engineering of a storm-proof, high-yielding rice plant type. So that is where we want to go. It's a great vision. And any ideas on how to make it work in terms of resources also would be highly welcome. Also partners, interested partners would be welcome. We are determined to do that, but it may take some time. Thank you.
And an unashamed call for funds. Always like that. So we have time for maybe one question. We haven't really talked much about genome editing up to now. So yeah, please go ahead. Yeah.
I think no one.
This is sort of more of a almost a philosophical question, maybe even for the modelers to think about. Now that phenotyping technologies are advancing and can measure more and more things on plants, how much should we continue to put on the concept of idiotype? For example, for your stormproof lodging, the thing is we might not already have a preconceived idea about that, while the phenotyping technologies could reveal something that we haven't thought of. What do you think about idiotypes?
I'm not naive, let's say, about idiotypes. There's a history of where just physiology and breeding just went advanced in parallel, and actually nothing came out of the idiotype work. Or there was also lack of understanding between the science or lack of collaboration. I still believe in idiotype work, but not in a naive way. I would say we have to be extremely open to the unexpected that comes out of the study of diversity. And there are so many, for example, correlations among trait occurrence in the diversity of germplasm that we find. Correlations that can be due to co-selection or to genetic linkage or to physiological linkage, and depending on what it is, you are more or less free to combine those things, and you have to take that into account. So I believe it is a useful concept also to extrapolate into target environments the thing you want to do, but you have to give room for the surprises nature has for you. And there's plenty of that every day.
Okay. Just to give a modeling perspective on that, I think we've really moved away from the idea of ideotypes. I mean, I think the value is in thinking about the traits that may have adaptive value. But you certainly, I think what I was trying to say, there are some you know about, and there's a big slab you don't know about. And that's where the interface with the quantitative genetics is critical, because there will be things you move from the unknown bucket into the known bucket when you know about them. And the phenotyping will help you find. And you can target phenotyping, but you know, so you've got to be careful not to constrain what your target is to
exactly
things that you know, because there are lots of things you don't know.
I'm very critical of the physiologist imposing ex ante knowledge onto these processes, because you tend to go completely wrong with that. It's just one more piece of information there. We are incorporating, or we are using, the concept of phenotypic plasticity very explicitly in these ideotype developments. We are acutely aware of how plastic the phenotype is, and this needs to be predicted as well, and not only, let's say, a static vision of an ideotype. That could be wrong. Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much, Michael. We have to move on, but please join me in thanking Michael.